For those who don't actually know who I am, so I'm just about to lead you in worship, but for those who don't know, I've come with Brian and Candace, and I'm from Tassie.
Yeah.
From the sunny island of Tasmania. It's definitely not sunny at the moment, so I'm enjoying this warmth. But I'm gonna lead you in a time of worship, and I'm actually gonna sing two songs that I've written, so no one's gonna know them. So I hope that you can pick them up really, really quickly. The first one is "We Will Dance." The second one is "Make Me Sweeter." So just, it's actually a slow worship one. So you might want to dance like that rather than that. So just see how you go. But you do what you want to do. So we're just going to, have a time of worship with the Lord. Lord, we welcome you here this afternoon.
Spirit of me.
let your fragrance permeate senses as you and I dance tonight. Oh, 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 oh. You are my joy, and you are my joy, you are my strength, you are my feast of delight. Lord, let your fragrance permeate senses as you and I dance tonight. Oh, 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 oh.
Before Brian gets up, I'm actually going to sing this song, and it's the last part of the Song of Songs that he was actually speaking on. So I'm truly the rose of his heart, the very theme of his song. Thank you, Lord, for your revelation. Teatro.
Just been danced off my feet. Jesus, we just thank you for coming and wrecking us just hour after hour. And we thank you that we won't be the same again, Lord, that you're loving us and the love that we've receiving is going to be contagious, dangerously contagious. Just go and find someone and dangerously love them. And then find your seats. Thanks. Let's just thank Caroline for her worship this afternoon. That was amazing. Thank you so much. Thank you. How many of you are getting wrecked in a good way? I'm getting totally messed up and loving it. I really asked the Lord to reignite my heart for the Word. I love the Word. I love the Bible. I've been reading it for a long time. But those four layers this morning, and just opening up vistas and vantage points that we haven't seen before, I'm sure Brian is wanting to equip us to do that. He's igniting our passion for Jesus and for His Word, and for the song of the Lord, and for every facet of how we bring that scripture to life, whether it's through art or music or dance or studying on our own. I just think that God wants to transform our devotions. Amen. He wants to wholly transform our devotion. And I'm loving it. As a pastor and someone who teaches regularly, I'm just having my heart wrecked every session. And that's what I hope for. I prayed for that. And thank you for those of you who are on the journey with us. It's amazing. And that's exciting. Izzy has and Jordan have some CDs at the back I'd like to just bring to your attention. Her three latest ones, Beloved, which has a lion on the front. A lot of Izzy's songs are written out of encounter. She encounters the lamb, the lion, angels. She gets downloads from heaven as the Lord appears to her and gives her songs. And those last three albums, Beloved, It Is Finished, and Beautiful Lamb of God, have all been recorded live at Jubilee. And so I'd encourage you to get those. Jordan's album is Calvary and All the Above. Caroline has some CDs as well. Thank you. So there we go. I didn't know that. That's wonderful. So there's resources. You know, what the beautiful thing about Encounter, and we've tried to build a church around people encountering Jesus. We have people healed in the glory, people encountering Him, people getting inner healing during the worship, and they're getting physically touched in their bodies. Come on. All right, we've got Zion's Hill. Wonderful. Zion's Hill, I Was Made, and Reflections, Caroline Billing. So bless you guys. Just, that's amazing. Her songs were just so precious this afternoon. So why I encourage you with those resources is that they're resources. They're resources to take us back into encounter, take us back into the throne. When you've had an encounter, you can go back there anytime you want to. You found the address. You found that sweet place. And, I've been on airplanes listening to some of our prophetic worship and just getting messed up, and the air hostess is walking past and wanting to know what to do with me. And I'm like, I'm fine, I'm all good. And because I'm going back into those times when we had those encounters, and they're online. You can get our prophetic worship online for free. You can just download it. And it's just that's what you do. You build a culture of encountering Jesus and never being far from Him, never being distant. We haven't got time to go backwards, just to go forwards. Amen. So let's welcome Brian back. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Oh, Lord.
Break us beyond repair. To be perpetually undone. You know, Isaiah, what a prophet. For five chapters, he spoke woe on everybody else. Much like prophetic ministry today. Until he saw the Lord high and lifted up. And then who did he speak the woe over? He spoke his seventh woe over him. He spoke six in five chapters. Woe to those that do this and that. But when he saw the Lord, he said, woe is me. And it's interesting that it was in the year King Uzziah died. What's up with that? What's so significant? You are so wise. Well, Uzziah was his uncle. Isaiah was the nephew of royalty. He had access in and out of the throne room on earth. And Uzziah, one day, Uzziah was a good king. He did many great things, really helped the nation of Israel. However, he got proud. The way of all flesh. He fell into the pride of man. And he wanted to go into the Holy of Holies and burn incense before God. 80 priests stood outside the door. 80 anointed priests tried to stop the king and said, King, you do not have the right to go in to the Holy of Holies. Only priests go in. You cannot go in. You're a king. He wanted to be more than he was. And when he went into the holy place, leprosy broke out. The mark of the beast broke out on his forehead because he was thinking he was better than he was, that he had more, he had more access and privilege than he truly had. When that leprous king died, Isaiah saw the Lord. Inside of you is a leprous king. When he dies, you will see the Lord. Selah. Up to this point, I've really tried to help you understand the breadth and depth and length of the Word of God, that there's more to the Scriptures than what we understand. The woman at the well. You'll never look at it the same now, will you? Isaiah, the throne room. The leprous king. There's so many scriptures that we think we know. You know, that you do not even know, we do not even know what salvation is yet. That there's a salvation coming that we've never experienced. Do you know that? 1 Peter 1:5, could you put that up on the screen? 1 Peter 1:5. Thank you, media team. I'm throwing these at you kind of out of nowhere. But 1 Peter 1:5 says that there is reserved, that there's the coming of a salvation that's ready to be revealed in the last days. There's a salvation that's waiting to be given to the church. We've not yet entered in to the fullness of salvation, and you have everything else figured out? And you don't even know what it means to be saved? There is coming such an upgraded Acts 2.0 upgrade version, Service Pack 2. There's coming heavenly downloads coming at a pace that is going to shock the daylights into the church. There's coming a salvation that is ready to be revealed. Do you see the word revealed? If I could get up there and circle it, I would. That word revealed is the name of the last book of the Bible. Apocalyptus, the unveiling. There's coming an unveiling. The unveiling is coming to the earth. The unveiling is coming, and it will bring a salvation that will save us so completely from the residue and the memories of sin. Because after all, the cross was only the day before yesterday. A day is like 1,000 years. That would be the day before yesterday. So we're fighting memories. And when this full salvation is unveiled, the sozo is unveiled completely. Even Bethel doesn't have it totally. Could I say that publicly? I just did. I mean, the church is famous for parking on plateaus.
We are pilgrimage. We go from glory to glory. You're stuck at two. Glory to glory. You're stuck at two. And like you said, dear friend, once you've been in there, you go from glory back into that glory anytime you choose. Remind me to tell you about when I was taken into heaven. But it's a little diversion right now, so we'll come back to it later. But this unveiling, he gave me two things in heaven. I want to tell you what they are. But anyway, the unveiling, it's... I got to tell you where the ark is. I got a lot to do yet today. Ready to be revealed in the last kairos. That's the word kairos, the appointed season. So if you put the pieces together, Peter is telling us that there is coming in the very last days an unveiling of the fullness of salvation to the church. And I believe a little bit of that I'm going to share with you tonight, what it may be, what it could be, a hint of what it could be. So I'm going to come tonight. I hope you will too. So my point is, you know, I wanted to share with you things that will open our hearts to a greater understanding of the Scriptures. And the know-it-all mentality that's in the Western church is impeding progress. It's keeping the church locked into the plateaus of spirituality and preventing us from going. We're stuck at two. And part of it is because we've undervalued revelation, we've undervalued the power of the Word, and we think we already know it. When Peter is saying, excuse me, you don't even know what salvation means yet. You get a hint of something and you get a, you know... You get a pint and you think it's an ocean. Come on. You get $5, you think you're a millionaire. And we don't understand that these are on-ramps to deeper, fuller understanding. These are but entrees to enter into the full meal. So that was this morning. This afternoon, I want to focus on God's divine method of maturing and growing Christians. Because you want to grow, don't you? You want to become the full stature, the look-alike partner to Jesus Christ. Don't you want everything you love about Jesus to be spoken over you? Well, how does God grow? How does Jesus grow his bride? How does God grow his church? How does he grow his vineyard? How does he mature us? What is the tool, what is the way and the means and the power source to grow us? I have found what it is. It's love. Every miracle can be traced back to love. The genesis of a miracle is love. And as we go deeper into the expanse of the love of God, we understand that he grows us not by slapping us and abusing his bride. Churches will do that for you. But he puts a crown on our head and watches us grow up to fit it. He gives us at the front end every spiritual blessing, knowing that we're not ready. He sent out 70 before he gave them the Holy Spirit. He released his people before he even called them. The methods of Jesus and how he leads and how he matures his flock is so different. You know, we pound the pulpit, we scream, we yell, We tell you what you have to do and what you're supposed to do and make you feel guilty for not doing it. I've read 8 chapters of the Song of Songs, translated it, memorized it, and there's not one angry exhortation in the whole book.
because he knows we shut down when that kind of spirit is upon us. When someone is venting and someone is telling us everything we're not, and when are we going to change? Why, you know, he calls us a dove, not a serpent. Aren't you glad you're not a buzzard or a crow, raven? You're a dove, my dove. I'm about to read to you a portion of the Song of Songs where he knows she is going to fail. He knows she is going to say no to him. He's going to come leaping over mountains, and he wants her on the mountaintop. He wants to bring her into the realm where she leaps with him in the high places. But she's not ready, and she's going to say no. In chapter 2, it's a little bit of a sad, it ends on a sad note. I'll work our way into this here before we're done. But my point is, knowing our future and knowing that we're going to fail, it's like Jesus calling Peter a rock, knowing he was going to betray him. And when he prophesied to Peter about the denial, the betrayal, and the cock crowing, you remember the rooster crowing? And you're going to deny me three times? But when you are converted, when you are restored, what did he say? Feel real bad for 5 years? When you are restored, never open your trap again. When you are restored, give up, because I'm never going to use you again. When you are restored, you're going to strengthen your brothers. And that verse I put up there that they had up on the screen was by Peter. There's something about Peter's writings, 1st and 2nd Peter, that supernaturally infuse strength into your being. There's an anointing on Peter's writings to give you strength, because God prophesied, the Lord prophesied, you are going to strengthen the church. Isn't it interesting you use the sign of a rooster crowing? I think of, you know, Peter, I think of him kind of like Rocky. Rock, you know, Rocky. Rocky. But Rocky got cocky. And the rooster crowing was a prophetic sign of what was happening in him. He was the rooster. I will never betray you. I'm better than they are. And the Lord unveiled this issue by the sign of the rooster crowing. And you know how he healed Peter? This is totally off track, but not necessarily. It's the love of Jesus. When Jesus was raised from the dead and he appeared on the Sea of Galilee, what was Peter doing when he first met Jesus? Fishing. And it was like Jesus reenacted that entire scene again. And he's saying, in effect, Peter, start over with me. I'll let you. You can have another shot at this. And he took him back in inner healing, so to speak, and he relived this calling where he actually told Peter the same words, throw your net on the other side, you remember? And the miracle catch of fish the second time. It was just total repeat, replay of what happened in Luke 5. And where did Peter deny Jesus? This would be good Bible trivia. Where was he at when he denied three times that he knew Jesus? Specifically, he was around a fire. And it says he was around a charcoal fire. Now, the reason all this is coming to me is because I just translated Acts. And it just, I just translated, Luke and Acts and this, and John, I should say, because it's in John. And it so hit me. Jesus absolutely replayed the whole trauma of his betrayal, of his denial. And Peter was warming his hands over a charcoal fire, and Jesus was serving breakfast over a charcoal fire. And three times Peter denied him. Three times Jesus healed him. Peter, This is the actual, I wish you had John. I guess the John, I had 50 copies sent here, but they never made it, sorry. But when you do get it, you'll be able to read it. But the actual text says in Aramaic, Peter, do you burn with love for me? Because Abba in Aramaic, Ahab in Hebrew, Abab in Aramaic means to burn and also means to love, to burn with love. Peter, do you burn with love for me? And Peter said, Lord, you know I like you. Peter, do you burn with love for me? It's starting to pierce him. Lord, you know I like you. Third time, Peter, do you like me? He said, you know, I burn with love for you. I burn with love for you. And Peter went on to live his life until he was martyred. And ancient Christian tradition says that Nero was killing Christians in Rome, and Peter was in Rome, and he ran from the persecution. He ran outside the city, and he was running down the road to escape for his life, and Jesus stood in front of him. He said, Peter, where are you going? Peter said, I'm going to go back and die for you. He went back into Rome, was, of course, apprehended. And as they were crucifying this apostle, he begged his crucifiers to turn the cross upside down. He said, I'm not worthy to be crucified the way my Lord was crucified. And they so respected this venerated man that they turned him upside down. And he was crucified in that way. Well, I hope I've not gotten off track too much, but my point is the love theology. People have said to me, you are overdosing on love. No, I get this a lot. And I, you know, I teach a lot. Guys, I preach a lot of sermons and stuff, but it's not that the only thing I talk about, but it's my favorite thing to talk about. And, you know, it says in Galatians 5:23 that against such things there is no limit, boundary. There's no law against love. There's no law against it. Matter of fact, love fulfills every law. So knock yourself silly. God will never rebuke you for being too loving. Never. He'll never come to you and say, I rebuke you for loving too much. He'll never tell you, you are too joyful. You should get depressed like the angels up here in heaven. He'll never slam you for having peace, too much peace. You should be anxious. You should worry like all of us up here in heaven are worrying. There is no law against these things. You cannot overdose. Impossible. So Jesus' method is not angry exhortations and guilt-driven theologies. He produces spiritual growth in our hearts by loving us beyond what we think we can take. And this girl's going to pass out at her own engagement party. And what happens is she's taken to the house of wine. Under the apple tree, she's feasted on him. That she's taken the virtues of his fruit, the sweet fruit of his presence. She's feasted on it so fully. Suddenly, she's transported, literally. She's brought into the house of wine. It's not banquet table. That's a wimpy translation because they didn't want to put wine in the Bible, I guess. I don't know. But Jesus took her into the wine cellar. He took her in. This is her engagement party. And the wine speaks of the Holy Spirit, the inebriating, intoxicating power of the Holy Spirit.
And this is her engagement party. He's saying, I'm going to fill you with the Holy Spirit as a sign of what I'm going to do in your life. Did you know that the Holy Spirit is the down payment? Ephesians 1. And that the word, the Greek word, and of course if you get the Passion Translation, this is all footnoted. The word for earnest or down payment or pledge or however it is in other translations, the word is actually engagement ring. The Holy Spirit is the engagement ring. The Holy Spirit is the bride's engagement ring. So, put a ring on it. Listen, sweetheart, if he comes knocking and wants to marry you, but the guy can't afford a wedding ring, wait a day or two. But if he comes and puts a rock on you, I mean, heavy, big rock, you know something good's coming. No worries, you're going to be fine. Well, what if Jesus puts the Holy Spirit, smears spirit life, spirit wind, spirit power, grace, giftings all over us? We are the spirit-drenched people of God. This is the house of wine. This is where we celebrate being the fiancé of the Son of God. And what happens is she passes out. She takes too much. Says, the banner of love, the flag over her heart, conquered heart, is the unrelenting banner of love. You've had the banner of insecurity. You've had a banner over you of your failures. You've had a banner over you of meeting expectations of others. But the banner he puts over you is a flag of love. So she just drinks and drinks and drinks of the Holy Spirit, and she starts to fade. And she says, revive me with your goblet of wine. Refresh me again with your sweet promises. Help me and hold me, for I am lovesick. Lovesick. I'm longing for more, but how could I take more? I want to live in that place between too much and not enough. One moment, too much. Next moment, give me more. I want to live in that realm continually of being this lovesick man that has fallen in love with the King of Glory. Is it okay for a man to talk that way? I hope so. I just did it. You know, I'm a recovering Baptist, and as a Baptist, we were taught that you don't go by emotions. Emotions are bad. Don't go by emotions. So everything gets stuffed. So we end up having an entire male culture of men that are stuffed, and their emotions are pushed down. Except when they get to see a sports event. Oh, I got to tell you, Aussie football is nuts, you guys. I'm telling Americans about your football. You guys are crazy. You can't be on the field without a broken bone or blood coming out. It's like rugby, soccer, and American football with no pads rolled into one. It's nuts. Aussie rules or whatever they call it, you know. I could only take about 10 minutes of it. It was like, ah, this is gladiator stuff. You guys, you rewrite. Aussie. You guys are rewriting this. So it's amazing how all this stuff comes out of the male heart when we're all told in church, don't go by your emotions. So you got men in the church with their arms folded, all the women up here dancing, and the men are going, well, that's crazy. I hope not. So she starts to pass out, and it says, do you get the mental picture here? His left hand is behind my head. His right arm is around me. Oh. She passes out. She can't take it. At her own party. And as she fades, the Son of God, Jesus the King, he turns to all of the guests at the party and says, I command you, I charge you in the name of Bambi. Even when he charges us, even when he like commands us, it's by the does and the gazelles. What? He is so tender, even when he commands us. Doesn't it say his commands are not burdensome? They're not grievous. So he commands by the does and gazelle. Have you ever been attacked by a little Bambi deer? I don't think you have anything to worry about. So the curtain falls. As the curtain falls, she's in his arms, and he tells them, basically, don't disturb her until she's ready. And so often the church wants to disturb the lovers. And you need to get up off the floor and go work in the nursery. I'm really using that one here. And we want people to work, 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 work. Serve, 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 serve. More, more, more. Leave her alone, he says. He puts a do not disturb card outside her door and says, until she awakens, she will serve, she will love, she will give her best to you and to the church and to the brothers, but let her have this time. In a season of intimacy. Can I say in chapter 3, I'm about to take you there, you're going to wish you were under the apple tree at the house of wine at your party, because she's going into the dark night of the soul. So when you're in a season of love and embrace, can I give you the best advice from a father to my kids? Enjoy it while it lasts, because it's a setup for what's coming. He knows to prepare her for what's ahead, she's going to have to be fully, imbibed. She's going to have to be fully, full, tanked up, full, complete, topped off with the love of God. So when you feel like you're in a season, this weekend even, where you're getting loved, you're getting affirmed, and everything, it's hard to imagine the kind of love he's pouring on our hearts, then you have Monday coming. You have family issues. You know what I'm saying? You have stuff at work. You have things that must be done. So when you're in a season like this, take all you can. Enjoy it while it lasts. Don't disturb her until she awakens. Now the curtain rises, and it's a brand new scene here in Song of Songs 2. And she's on her couch behind her wall. But she looks through the window and she sees a strange sight. It's the shepherd guy, except he's leaping over mountaintops. Woo! Iron Man, like, woo! 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 He's jumping over hills, like Superman, just leaping into the heavenly realm and then coming back down, touching the earth, only to leap again. He's coming to her, and he's joyfully dancing over mountaintops, coming to his fiance. Says, listen, the sound of my beloved. Look, here he comes. We hear and then we see. And he comes to her over the mountains. What are the mountains? Anything that gets in the way between you and God. The mountains of fear, the mountains of insecurity, the mountains of I'm not ready yet, the mountains of I can't do that, mountains of doubt. But he jumps over them like they're nothing, and they are to him. Everything that you think is in the way between you and God is nothing to him. Nothing to Jesus. effortlessly. He jumps and leaps and dances over all the things that you think keep you away from him. And he jumps right in front of her, to her house. And he peers into the window of her soul. And he looks into the patchwork, the lattice of her soul. And she's sitting on a couch, eating chips. And what's a good snack here? Chocolate. Yeah, chocolate. Watching telly with a remote control. She's got to remotely control everything, you know. And he says, I need to make this quick because I got to get you into the dark night of the soul. But he says, arise and come away. Do you remember way back last night when we started? She said, draw me and I will run. She's not going to. And how many times has it happened with you that you say, Lord, I'll go anywhere. I'll do anything. I will go with you, God. I am your. I'm absolutely yours. Yeah. Until he asks you what you don't want to hear, what you really just do not want to. I don't want to have to go back to that. I don't want to go do that. I don't want to go say I'm sorry. I don't want to go and heal a relationship or. But she said, draw me and I will run. He's coming. He's going to draw her. And she won't run. 7 times he says words to her. The 7 prophecies over her. The winter is past. The winter is the cold, barren season. The cold wind, the brutal season that they have down in Tassie. He says, it's over. Your winter ended when I showed up. And he repeats these 7 signposts of a changing season. He's trying to tell her, your season has ended. What you expect me to do, I'm going to do what I choose to do. And your season of me just loving you under apple trees and telling you how amazingly stunning you are, I'm still going to tell you that, but I'm going to ask you now to rise and go into a new realm. Come into a new season. Come into a new place. Come learn mountain climbing. Come learn mountain leaping. Come learn the supernatural, effervescent way of my life. I came into your world. Now you come into my world. Come and learn the ways of eternity. Come to the high place. You're not made for a couch. Let go of your remote control and chocolate. And come, arise. And he calls her my love, and he actually calls her my dove, my dove. Why would he say that? I would think turtle, tortoise might be better. He says the sound of singing has come. This worship is in the air. Worship has soaked your heart. You've been on the carpet. You've let me kiss you, and you've kissed me back. Now arise. It's a new season. You thought it was only about you. It's actually about me. And I have a plan for you. I have a purpose that I can only unfold to you there. Not on the couch. Not behind your wall, where I have to look through the patchwork of your soul to see the real you. But I want you to be free and come and soar in the high place. I'm calling you to a new way to live, a new life. And she's going to say, no thanks.
I don't do mountains. I do conferences. I don't do mountains. I do church services. I listen to podcasts. I'll buy the video. I will tell everybody that you leap over. I'll stand up in church and give a testimony. Whoa, I had an encounter. Jesus came leaping over mountains. Of course, I'll leave out the part about I didn't go with him when he told me. So he's doing everything he can to convince her. And he's doing everything he can. We call it wooing. He's wooing your heart. So this weekend, you're getting a spa. You're getting a massage. You're getting a holiday. You're getting everything that is delightful rolled into one times 100. But it's so that you arise and come into a new dimension where you no longer are ingrown and inward thinking and introspective about your life, and instead blend into mine. Come into my world. Come into this place where nothing is impossible, where I can teach you mountain leaping in a day. And he looks in her eyes and sees she's not going to go. And he still loves her. Because he knows the end of your story. He knows that the mess is momentary, but destiny is forever. He knows the seasons of our lives, that there are moments when we make our boast, I will go with you, like Peter, I'll do anything, I'll go and say and do and be, until he actually challenges us to get out of our world and come into this new place, out of our comfort zone, no longer a couch. It's mountains. And she, you know what's keeping her back? What's keeping her back? What's the one word? Fear. And if you have ears to hear it, what's keeping you back? It's fear of, I don't know if I'm ready. What if I get halfway up the mountain and slide down? I've never done mountains like this. He wants me to go up a dark mountain trail. It's like I'm going to go into a mystery with somebody I barely know. I barely know him. I just know I love him. But what if he fails me? What if he can't get me all the way? Or what if I fail him and halfway up I stumble and I fail him? So all of these fears are in her heart. I just can't leave. I can't go. And the turmoil increases. And he says to her again, arise, my love. Come away. Come away with me. The secret in that verse is with me. Because if I'm calling you, I will strengthen you. I will hold you. Everything in her wants to go, but that fear, like a tether, keeps her tied to the predictable, to what we can manage. Can you see it in her? Can you see it in you? So what will he do? What's the thing that's holding her back? Fear. So what will he do for the rest of the book? What is it that casts out fear, by the way? All right. He's not going to yell at her. He's not going to slap her and say, why, you buzzard, you turtle, you hippopotamus. Of all the animals he chose, he chose the one that is used for the Holy Spirit. You remind me of the Holy Spirit. I love you, my dove. Look at verse, 14? My dove, come away, rise. And he says, I placed you not in a cage. I placed you in the cleft, the split open rock of my wounded heart, the rock of ages, cleft for me. I have placed you in the wounds of my heart. I have put you inside my heart and covered you
the blood of the cross. And then he says, I've placed you, this is really crazy, he says, I've actually put you where I want to take you. I've seated you in the high place. The Hebrew is so beautiful, and that it's where I got the name of our ministry. Our ministry is called Stairway Ministry. And he says, I put you in the secret stairway of the sky. I've hidden you up on high into the secret stairway of the sky. I've placed you where I'm going to take you. What's there to fear? Isn't that beautiful? That you're already there in his eyes. Those he justified, he also glorified. You are seated with Christ in heavenly realms. You know, Colossians 3 says we set our affections on things above because that's where we are. We're placed there. Our life is hidden in Christ, not from Christ. Our life is hidden in Christ with God. I like that stairway. It occurs many times in the Bible. You have the highway of holiness, and of course it comes from it comes from Genesis 28, where Jacob ran from his estranged brother Esau, remember, after he ripped off the inheritance, and he ran, and as God would have it, guess where Jacob landed, where he ended up spending the night. It started to get dark. He was at the very place where his grandfather Abraham built an altar, Bethel. And he took a stone from his grandfather's altar. He took the anointed stone because his grandfather anointed it and said, this will be the house of God. His grandson Jacob takes that stone, and what does he do? He puts it under his head. And he lays his head upon the anointed stone. And he saw what? Staring. And what was on the stairway? Now, are you sitting down? Angels in the Bible can be men, or they can be the heavenly things, critters, beings. Jacob didn't see heaven's angels. He saw men rising as angels. If you look at the text, it says the angels were ascending, going up, and descending. They started on earth. If it was the angels of heaven, they would have been descending and ascending. You are climbing Jacob's ladder. We are climbing Jacob's ladder. We are the angels. The book of Revelation 2 and 3, seven churches had seven angels who were the pastors and apostles of those churches. Men are angels. Paul said, you received me as an angel from God. To the angel of the church. The angel didn't need to read a letter. It was to the leadership of the church. So without taking 10 minutes to explain all of it, we are the last days angelic messengers going up and down. Go up and get your inheritance. Go up and see what Jacob saw. Go up and receive the promises. Last day's intercessors will rise that stairway. You have every access boldly by the blood of Jesus. You can go where the blood has gone. The blood has provided a sprinkled path for you to enter in. As you see the blood, the way the Father sees the blood, the way the angels see the blood, and the way Jesus sees the blood, if you'll see it that way, then you will have access into that realm. Still okay? Then Nathaniel in John 1, sitting under the fig tree. His brother Andrew came and got him, took him to Jesus, and Jesus had a word of knowledge, said, I saw you under the fig tree. It shocked Nathaniel. And Jesus said, you think that's something? You will see heaven opened, and the angels of God ascend and descend. And once again, it was leaving earth first and going up into the heavenly realm. You have every right to take your place at the right hand of God. You have been blood-bought, seated there, promised the inheritance.
crowned, robed, and enthroned, to use Paul's terminology, glorified. You are the regal bride. You are the royal, royal bride of Christ. Okay, so then he says, Song of Songs 2:14, he says, show me your face. For your face is lovely. Tell the person next to you, especially if you're married to them, your face is lovely. How many times have we asked the Lord, you know? We say, Lord, show me your face. I just want to see your face. The song, it says, I think I can make it if I could just see your face. Show me your face, Lord. If I could just see your face. Lord says, show me your face. Your face is lovely. Your voice is sweet. Your face is lovely. Your voice is sweet. Wow. Now you all know about Saul of Tarsus. He became Paul because of an encounter he had on the same place you're going to have it. The road to Damascus. You are on the road to Damascus. He refuses to kiss a bride with a veil. Yuck. Who would, what bridegroom would kiss a bride with a veil on? And he refuses to let you have shame as a veil. He says, I'm the lifter of your head. Show me your face. Speak to me. Let me hear your voice of intercession. Let me hear your cry for transformation. I will work in your soul. I will get you to the mountain. You don't have to fear. I will help you if you will show me your face, lovely face, and let me hear the sweet voice of prayer. Why would you withhold from Jesus what he really likes the most? But he knows what's keeping her back, so he says, catch for us the foxes. Catch the foxes that come out at night and spoil the vineyard. Whenever the vineyard is starting to bloom and bear fruit, these little things come out and they nibble away and they chew away and they destroy the fruit. And the vines never produce because foxes come out at night. He's saying, let's go on a fox hunt. Let's go catch foxes. Is there anybody in the Bible that ever caught foxes? What was his name? Samson. Does anybody know how many foxes he caught? 30. When's the last time you caught one? You know what he did with 15 pair of foxes? He tied their tails together. You think I'm radical? Samson tied foxes' tails, he caught 30, put them in pairs, and he put a torch, tied a torch between their tail. Woo! And then he kicked them out into the wood, hay, and stubble of the Philistines. The fox becomes a spiritual metaphor, a picture. Remember, God speaks in picture. So what is it? What are we catching foxes? What does this mean? The fox is a picture of spiritual compromise. It's the issues of our heart that we haven't unfolded. It's like the deep part of our pocket we haven't emptied out yet before God. Places, pockets of darkness, compromise, hidden things. It could be habits. It could be disgusting thoughts or ways or issues of our life that we've never come clean with. And he's saying, look, you're not going to go to the mountains if you won't catch these foxes. I tell you what, let's do it together. Let us catch them. I will help you.
And she says, kind of a bizarre cop-out, she says, but, you know, we all think it's really sweet what she's saying, I am yours and you are mine. But what she's really saying is, isn't it enough that I stay where I'm at because you're still mine and I'm still yours and we'll just get along and we'll just make do with what we have and we'll make it work, Jesus. You can do mountains and come and see me and I can do couch and remote control eating my chocolate and an occasional conference to tell everybody how wonderful you are. But I can't go there. No. You are mine. I am yours. Let's leave it at that. Sound good? And she says, until the day breaks and the shadows flee, turn. It's actually, the Hebrew is the word return. Go back where you came from. She basically says, she spurns his advance, his invitation, and she says, I'm not ready. Come another time. When I'm more mature, when I grow up, when I glow in the dark, come, and then I'll go. Then I'll go and do mountains with you. But you want me to be a bride on the mountaintop? You want to be a bride of the mountains? The day hasn't even broken. It's still night. It's the dark shadows. The shadows of doubt are still lingering in my soul. So go back until the brightness of a day has come. And all the shadows have disappeared. And that's what we all say all the time, don't we, folks? I'm not ready. It's like God didn't know what he's doing when he tells you to rise and come. God shows up before man. Man always says, I can't. I don't believe it. Who am I? God shows up to a woman named Mary. She says, okay, whatever you say.
Come on.
Done. Done with that one. So the curtain falls on this scene on Broadway. The people are stunned because they've seen this beautiful Shulamite be loved and affirmed and cherished and told over and over. And she even admitted, I'm the rose, I'm the theme, I'm the one he loves. He set his heart on me. He took me to the house of wine. I tasted the sweet apples. I've danced the night with him. He let me rest in his embrace. And yet when he comes to challenge me to a new dimension, the people are stunned. And as the lights dim, curtain starts to fall. The light all focuses down upon her face. As he goes up by himself, like she requested, he goes up the dark mountain trail. And he leaves her. And the curtain falls. And we'll take a 2-minute break. Wow. You know, guys, I'm going to go ahead, and I know I only took maybe a 2 or 3 minute break, but I want to get you through the dark night of the soul, and then tonight, body parts. And we're going to talk about what the hair stands for, and teeth, and the cheeks, neck. Everybody back? How about a question or two? We're going to wait a couple minutes. Any questions so far? I love the pomegranate. The pomegranate, that's quite a story in my life about the pomegranate. Oh, wow. That may take a moment. Yeah, we may go there. We may have mass transportation thing. The Lord's told us that there would be entire congregations, meetings, that the heavens would open and everyone at once would be an opened heaven into the realm. He's told us that that's coming. And the prophets know this, that it's coming. This season. Man, this is only chapter 2. I have so many things to tell you. This is so exciting. So many twists and turns. And you think you have Song of Songs figured out just because you've read it a few times. Oh, wait until you see what he does. All right. Now, the curtain closed, remember? The Shulamite. And by this time in the play, in the drama, in the opera, she literally changes. From scene to scene, she becomes even more beautiful. She starts out kind of homely, dirty hair, goat stuff on her robe, angry, kind of upset with the church, how they failed her. The church let me down. So, now she's starting to become more beautiful, and it's just amazing that she said no, isn't it? And yet it is with us too, that he would come and say, I want to teach you new things. You have to unlearn to learn. This is what kept Israel from the Messiah. They had to unlearn all of these things. So she says, Go back to the mountains. Oh, the mountains of Bether, or separation. I didn't explain that. The mountains, the Hebrew word is Bether, B-E-T-H-E-R, and it is the word for separation or gap. And Bether mountains were traditionally considered to be the mountains of holiness. Go back into the holy realm you came from. I'm not good enough to go with you. Come again another time when the day breaks and the shadows are gone, and then I will go. But until then, go be like the gazelle. Go dance again on the mountains without me. So he does. He goes up this dark mountain trail. And you guys see like the movie Field of Dreams? You remember when the guy goes into the cornfield and kind of disappears, real fade, kind of fades out? That's how we're going to do it on Broadway. So Jesus goes up here, and he just, you kind of see him going up the dark trail, and then he just fades out. And he left her, right? No. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. He only stopped where she couldn't see him. And we in the audience, we will notice, because there will be a very thin cloth, scrim, whatever they call that,
cheesecloth, whatever it's called, and faint light, and we'll be able to see what he did. Is he actually goes up the trail just far enough that she can't see, and then he turns around because he cannot leave her ever. And he will never leave you ever. Never. It's a lie that would say that he left you. He never will. But she doesn't know that. And she's like, ugh. A new scene, curtain rises. She's on the bed. On the stage is a bed. And there she is in her robe, in her jammies, pajamas. And she is tossing and turning in the sheets of her own bed. And she says in chapter 3, verse 1, night after night, I looked for him but could not find him. So she spent the sleepless night, right? How many of you know the dark night of the soul can be a dark decade? It can be more than a night. It can last a while. And many times, this dark, morose, difficult, melancholy season is our own making. It's because we said no to the challenge to go to a higher place, to live above our feelings and our emotional pain and our limitations, our fears, and to live in his realm, free, completely free. So night after night, she is tormented by her own memory of I said no to him. But the whole time, he's on the stage behind the cloth, watching her, loving her, praying for her. You know, God will test us. Ask Abraham. And the higher your calling, the more thorough will be your preparation, the more thorough will be your testing, so to speak. And I constantly get tests I never asked for. But actually, I did. I just didn't realize it. When I said, Lord, take me. I want to be fully yours. Here's how God heard it. Break me. Wreck my life. Let me have only what you want me to have. He interprets. He filters out our heart language. And he knows what we're really saying. And he will ensure that our preparation will be complete and thorough. So, she finally finds the key to get rid of depression. And these five words will deliver you forever. You'll never be depressed again if you'll listen to these five words and do it. You sitting down? Okay. I will get up now. Depression is rooted in passivity. The reason we get depressed is because we take it and we let it come without aggressively warring and fighting the good fight of faith and wearing the armor and doing the work of guarding our soul and keeping watch, you know, and doing what God expects us to do. So, you know, depression is rooted in a passive spirit. And when men get set free from a passive spirit, they become champions. When women are free from passivity, and you stop just letting, you know, you're like a leaf blowing by whatever breeze is blowing that day. But instead, you become secure as a lover of who you really are. And the wind may blow a direction you don't want it to blow in, but you know that it'll shift and change. And favor will come back and be restored to you. So self-pity is the devil's babysitter. She says, somebody's getting free. Get rid of, kick the babysitter out. You don't need that thing. So she says, verse 2, I will get up now. I will go into the city and search for him. Now, the city, this is real important that you understand this. The city is the local church. The biblical term or metaphor for the city is the local church. Jesus said, you're a city set on a hill. Abraham looked for a city whose architect and engineer was God.
we're all going to end up becoming a city. I'll talk about that tomorrow. The New Jerusalem is not what you think. I can't do this. I got to tell you now. Okay. You are not going to the New Jerusalem. Get it straight, folks. You're going to be the New Jerusalem. It is coming down here. You are not going to it. It is coming here. And it's a city that looks like a what? Adorned, beautified, radiant for her husband. The church is going to morph. Just as Israel couldn't understand the church coming out of the branch, believers in the church today have no grid to understand that this too will pass, and we're going to morph into the God-mingled company of the 200% human beings, God and men mingled together. When we grow up, we'll learn some more about this. Maybe some other day I'll come and teach more about it. But the city that we're going to be the New Jerusalem. It's the mother of us all. It's where we're born. We're born in the womb of the New Jerusalem reality, the Zion realm. Zion, the city that is above. We are all born in Zion. We are a Zion company. Zion is not a place, it's a people. You're not going to Zion. We are the Zion company. We are Zion realm. We've already come to Mount Zion. We're there. We're in a realm of reality where God and man mingle. Jesus was the 200% man. God and man mingled. The Father says, I like that. I'm going to populate the earth with people just like that. He becomes the perfect son, the pattern cornerstone. He becomes the model, and he brings many sons to glory. I said he brings many sons to glory. He glorifies sons. So many of you are looking for the second coming. All of the creation is groaning and travailing, not for the second coming. For sons. For manifest sons. For the sons to come forth. The created order is groaning and travailing, not for Jesus to come back, but sons to arise. Oh, I'm fighting how deep to go into this with you. To go out of the wading pool or go deep enough to swim in, over your head. Woo. Well, all right. You asked for it. So the New Jerusalem, miniaturized, was the breastplate of the high priest. 12 stones, 12 gates. Still with me? And engraved on every stone was a name, a transformed son. A stone was a son. A son was a stone. Living stones. And the 12 gates, a gate, think about a gate with me. I know this sounds juvenile, but listen. A gate takes you from one realm into another realm, right? So a son is a gate. The name of the son is the gate you enter into that realm. The 12 sun stones or stone suns are gates into the New Jerusalem reality. And you must pass through 12 gates to become the New Jerusalem company. The first stone was Reuben. It's more than a sandwich.
Reuben means, you know what this means. Reuben, what does Reuben mean? Behold a son. Reuben means behold a son. How do we enter the New Jerusalem? That's the first experience you have to pass through. You behold the son. And I could take a week to take you through those 12 encounters, those 12 experiences. You must pass through all 12, and then we become the New Jerusalem reality on the earth, where God and man mingle as one. The God-mingled people. You don't know where you end and he begins, because two have become one. And every wedding is a faint picture, mirage of that reality of two becoming one. You're going to be a 200%er. Everything you love about Jesus will be said about you. Your destiny is greater than you realize. So God's preparation will be greater than you realize. Let's fast forward to the last stone. There's so much levels of revelation between these 12 gateways. You got this next one is Simeon, which is he who hears. It's the hearing of our heart to the word of God. And the Simeon stone, the Simeon gate, Levi's next. It means being joined to the Lord as one. But the very last son, what was the last stone, the last gate, the last son? Benjamin. Benjamin means son of my right hand. The journey of beholding the son to becoming the son. Brings you to the New Jerusalem reality. I know you'd really rather have the, what is it, the Peshat, but I'm going into the sod, and I'm not coming back. And there's much more. You know, the gold. The streets of gold, there's only one street actually, and it's only one highway of holiness. Gold is the holiness of God, and that we're going to walk in holiness. And I know we make everything literal, and that's okay. But there's so much more hidden, secret. Remember, he tucks the revelation of his word, he hides it into his glory robe. And the only way you're going to get it is to come into the golden glory and pull that revelation out. The books are being opened. Many are going here and there. Revelation is increasing. God wants his bride to be full of light. If your eye be single, your whole body is full of light. If we're focused on the glorious sun, then our entire spirit body will be full of revelation light. So there's much more that he wants to make us. He wants to make us the lampstand. Remember in Revelation chapter 1, Jesus walks among the seven lampstands. And the seven lampstands are the seven churches. So the church is a lampstand. We are a lampstand. We're told not to hide our light under a bushel, but to put it on a lampstand. And if we lose our first love, he can come and take away the lampstand. And we no longer shine into our city, into our sphere of influence. I know you're tired at this time of the afternoon, but can I unveil the lampstand real quick before I get you through the dark night? Seven branches. Seven spirits. The lampstand is a picture of the spirit of truth in us. Seven branches to the lampstand. Isaiah 11, starting at verse 2, you have the seven spirits of God. Now, I teach weekend seminars on the seven spirits of God. I had somebody tell me that it's unbiblical. It's not in the Bible. I said, oh, you're right. If you'll take out four verses and cut them out, you're right. Then it won't be in the Bible. Isaiah 11. Verse 2 speaks of the seven spirits of God. and compares it. He's saying the branch comes out of Jesse's cut off stump. There is a sprout. There is something branching out of the Davidic kingdom that was cut off. There's coming a light and a branch. Now, when Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the... They all knew he was talking about Isaiah 11. They had no problem understanding that they were the lampstand, the branches of the lampstand. I am the vine, the central one. You are the sixth number of man, three on each side. You are the branches in me. And as you live in me, light will burn and passion and fire will burn in you, okay? The lampstand was designed supernaturally by the Holy Spirit to be hollow, one piece of gold, one solid piece of gold. You can only imagine the dimensions and how expensive this would have been, costly. And it was hollowed out to where oil could be poured into the central shaft, and then it would go to the other branches, and they only needed to anoint the central one because Christ is anointed above all his brothers. And Jesus is the anointed one. Christ means anointed one, right? Six is the number of man, three on each side. In the branch itself, in the gold, was engraved fruit. Three stages of fruit bearing. Bud, blossom, fruit. Every branch had that, three on each side, had it sequentially, bud, blossom, fruit, three times. So bud, blossom, fruit, bud, blossom, fruit, bud, blossom, fruit, and then it would burn there at the top. Three times three equals nine fruit of the Spirit. Every one of us are fruit-bearing branches. Six branches on the side, on three on each side. Six times nine equals four. It's amazing how many people can't get that correct. So now the central shaft, like I said, it pictures Christ. He is the one, it's really his anointing. We have his anointing. He's the anointed one, and we are anointed in him. So the central shaft had the bud, blossom, fruit sequence, but because it was taller, it had it four times. So bud, blossom, fruit, three times four equals 12. That is the apostolic number. The government of the church is upon him. He is the chief apostle, Hebrews 3:1, and high priest. He's the one that has the anointing. He is the apostolic government of the church. Amen? So if you add the 54 plus 12, you come up with 66 books of the Bible. Thy word is a lampstand under my feet and a light under my path. So the word and the spirit burning in fire becomes revelation light for the church. And I don't have time to tell you of the rest of Isaiah 11. I will be putting out a second edition of Isaiah. I did the first eight chapters. I'm putting out another book soon. They'll have the branch and the lampstand. It's actually going to be called the branch. But I'll show from Isaiah 11 that these animals, where Isaiah says the lion will lie down with the lamb, and then he goes on and on about all of these animals that are going to be subdued. Okay, every one of them have a counterpart to human nature. Every one of them are a nature, a wolf, a little child. Jesus said you have to become like a little child. So all of it's picturing the subduing of the power of God to subdue that roaring, clawing, scheming thing in you. To the lamb will lie down with it. See? The lamb. And that under the lampstand, under the light of revelation, the subduing of the issues of our heart are totally settled. Okay, well, I couldn't have taken you more around from the New Jerusalem to the lampstand. Now I got to get you back to the dark night of the soul. Now, thank you guys. You're so kind and patient with me. I feel your hunger pulling it out. That's why I keep getting sidetracked. So forgive me for being a little bit not linear in how I've said these things. So what happened? Oh, now I know where I got off. The city. The church is the city, right?
And this will occur one other time in the Song of Songs. We'll talk about it tomorrow. But the church is a city. She says, I will go about the city and look for my beloved. You know where you're going to find Jesus? The church you left. It's the local church. It's within his body. Where two or more are gathered, you're going to have fights. Is that what he said? That's pathetic is what that is. Where two or more are gathered, there am I. See? So if you can't find Jesus, where are you going to go? Find his people. Go back. There's no more out-of-body experiences. And any teaching that takes you out of the body of Christ, there are two significant, really, really basically okay, alluring, attractive teachings that are warring in the church right now. One of them is law and the other is grace. And one is the Hebraic roots movement that's trying to make everybody Jewish. Now, the essence of it, and I wish you'll listen to me, and it'll spare you and your church in a lot of pain because it's dividing the house of God many places. The Hebraic roots movement, I'm not going to tear things down. That's not who I am. It's not what I want to do, not what why I came. I'm just giving you a little bit of a warning that the body of Christ is precious to him, and you can't say, I'm not of the body. You are dependent upon the body. And I'm dependent upon the body. You know, I'm here with you as a local body ministering under the authority of the shepherds here. But the law is really trying to make people keep Sabbath and keep all the feasts. Let me tell you, every day's a Sabbath, and Jesus fulfilled the feast. Okay, can I just get that off my chest? Ah, I feel better. The Sabbath is a man. The Sabbath is Jesus. It's a relationship. It's not a day. And Paul said, there are those who will honor one day above another, and then others that honor every day alike, so be it. That's what he's saying. Well, I'm one that honors every day alike. So be it. So the law keeping, to try to put the church back into this, you're not good enough. You have to do this to be close to God. You need, okay, you got good stuff, but when you do this with us, with Shabbat, and do all these things, then you're really close to God. Not at all. Really. You have a wonderful insights into the Hebraic culture, which is fascinating. I go to Israel. I love Israel. I paid a price for my love for Israel, so you'll never get anywhere telling me I have an issue with Israel, because I don't. The other extreme is the opposite of it's so finished, you don't do nothing. And you're religious if you do anything. And it labels and it divides, and it's like, okay, mate, I was going to say bro, but mate, I have preached this for 42 years. I grew up on this. I am a total grace guy. I hope I've not put one ounce of law on you. Never would I want to do that. But to say he doesn't challenge us and we don't need to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling, and that there's no warnings in Hebrews and there's nothing in the scripture that says we have to do anything. It's finished, but you're not. We're still unwrapping it finished, aren't we? It's finished. I know that. You know, and they put it on my Facebook all the time. It's finished. I know that. But you ought to understand, it's just finished. I know that. Now go into all the world and preach the gospel. After it's finished, go preach. Go heal the sick. Go do this. Pray without ceasing. Is that law? No. So you see what I'm getting at? The two extremes are tugging at the precious body, the unity of the body of Christ here in Australia. And I want to add my voice. I hope it's not confusing in any way, but I want to add my thoughts to bring the body together. We're one, Jew and Gentile. The wall has been broken down. There's no male or female. There's no Jew or Gentile. We don't rebuild a wall and say, get on this side of the wall and you're closer to God. The wall's done. It's finished. There you go. It's done. It's fallen. So she goes out into the city, and guess who she finds? Pastors. She finds the overseers, those that keep watch over the city. They're out in the city streets keeping watch. They're doing what they're called to do. Now, there are really good pastors in Australia. You are blessed. You have a lot of really good pastors. And there may be a few, very few, there may be a few that are abusive, that are controllers, and that hurt the flock. But they're rare. There's tremendous leadership in this nation. And when I think of Australia, I think of the apostolic. I really think, you know, I think of men that I've met. Some of them now have passed on to their inheritance, but that were Australians that impacted me having to do with the apostolic. So leadership is really a beautiful thing that you have here. Thankfully, in this chapter, she finds the good ones. In chapter 5, she finds the other ones. But here in chapter 3, they're doing what they're called to do, and she, can you see it? She grabs them and says, "Have you seen him whom my soul loves?" And every believer has a right to hold, to look at their pastor and say, "Have you seen him? Have you seen the one I love?" And we better have a good answer. No, I'm in it for the money. Mm-mm. No, it's just a career for me. No, have you seen him? So the text is really clear. It says, scarcely had I gone past them that I saw him. You got to go past your leaders. Go past your leaders. And if they're good leaders, they'll want you to. Get over it. Get over your leaders. Their flaws, their strengths, their weaknesses. Get over that. See him. Go after him. And we in ministry, we are aquariums, see-through servants, where hopefully you can see the one we love inside. That's all we are, is we are see-through servants, pointing you to the one you love. Go past them, and immediately, this is so cool, I can't wait to do this on Broadway. Here they are, and suddenly he has been in the scene the whole time. He's been there the whole time. We could see him, but she didn't know that he was actually there. So powerful. And then suddenly, the screen lifts, and there he is. Ah! She found him. And she falls at his feet and says, "I will not let you go." It's like Mary in the garden. It's like Mary in the garden. Remember, held when the gardener, she realized that he wasn't a gardener, but he really is a gardener. But not the gardener she thought. And she held on to him, and he said, "Mary, I'm sorry, I got to go. I have to go to heaven." And she said, "I don't want to let you go." Here in Song of Songs, she says, "Until I take you to my mother's house, into the place where I was conceived." Now, the mother's house is the church. We were all born again in the womb of the church, and we're to honor our father and our mother. I want to bring you back into church life. I want to bring you back into that messed up church. I want to bring you back into the confused church scene. I want to bring you and let you be released through me into the church. Curtain falls as she's still clinging to him. Powerful. Brand new scene. Curtain rises. This is so awesome. The whole stage is filled with smoke. Holy smoke. Like it's the glory cloud. I told my worship pastor when I was leading our church, I said, his name was Mike. I said, "Mike, I want a smoke machine." He said, "Pastor, you really want a smoke?" I said, "Yeah, I really love, I want smoke. Like, I want you guys to play the keyboard and there's smoke. Like, you're in the cloud and you're playing the guitar. and the drum smoke right up to here. I said, get a smoke machine. He said, okay. So he got a smoke machine. It malfunctioned. It would not, we could not stop it. It came and it came and it came, and the whole church was full of smoke, and the fire alarm went off, and the firemen came, and it ruined our service. I said, Mike, put it on eBay, sell the smoke machine, no more. Don't tell them it's broke, just sell it. So that's my one smoke story. Okay, so the scene begins with the curtain rising, smoke everywhere, and all of a sudden, he'll come up from the bottom of the stage, the door will open, and it's Jesus.
Who is this rising as cloud of glory out of the wilderness? Who is this ascending in the clouds?
And every eye is on the ascending of Jesus. Light is going to shine from this way out to him, so that it, like, your eyes are like blinded, and the dazzling radiance. This is the ascension of Jesus. It's going to be awesome. Come to Broadway when we do this. Now, every eye goes all the way up as we, you know, wires or something. He's going to go up, and he goes all the way up, and everybody watches Jesus rise up into the ceiling, and they don't realize there's something else on the stage. And all of a sudden, the smoke clears. It's the marriage carriage. It's the palanquin. It's called a palanquin. It's this like couch thing that has bars that run through it, and then men carry it, you know, on their shoulders. The king and queen are going to ride in this comfy. He forgot to tell you something. When he said, arise and come to the mountains, he was going to carry you there. He just wanted you to say yes. You don't have to go up the dark mountain trail. He'll take you there. All you had to do was say yes. He'll carry you there. Have you guys seen that picture of that, you know, where the real buff guys like I used to be in a short skirt and a armband, and they're carrying the couch on their shoulders going up? It's called a palanquin. Is there anything else in Israel's history that was like carried that way on their shoulders? So he's going to take you in the mercy seat to the mountains. He's going to carry you in the mercy seat. Oh, you are the mercy seat. You are the Ark of Covenant. I found it. Where's my camera? It's right here. You are, will you listen? Drop your guard a little bit and listen. The ark was made of wood and gold from the earth and from heaven. It's you. Inside and out, coated with gold. Inside and out, coated with gold. And overshadowing you are angels. Has blood been sprinkled on your conscience? And there's a crown that goes all the way around the mercy seat. He's crowned you with glory and honor. Do you know the same things that are in the ark are in you? There's three of them. The golden jar of manna is in you. Jesus says, I'll give you the secret manna. I'll give you hidden manna. You see, you are a golden vessel filled with Wonder Bread.
it makes you wonder what it is. Because manna means, what is it? Yes. What is it? Yes. Can't you see the Jewish mom telling her boy, go outside the tent early morning. Yaakov, go get what is it? Yes, mom, but what is it? Yes, go get it. But what is it? Yes, go get it. But what is it? Yes. 40 years God fed people with mystery. And the church for 2,000 years has done everything it can to remove mystery from our hearts. We want it line upon, we want to understand, we want it right here. If we don't understand it, it's not God. This is why, as a Baptist, I was a cessationist for a long time. I was a hyper-dispensational cessationist, and please don't try to figure that out. But I was one of those. And I didn't believe in the Holy Spirit gifts today. You know, when John croaked on Patmos, all the gifts ended. And I didn't realize that 1 Corinthians 13:8, when it says that which is perfect is come, is love. Perfect love. That which is perfect. It's in the middle of the love chapter. When that which is perfect is come, that which is partial fades away. Nothing can take its place. Yeah. Knowledge, gifts, faith, wisdom, nothing. They'll all make us talk like children. But when we are mature, love, the perfect thing comes. So, God wants to show us that there's no limit to Him. And He wants to ravish us with mystery. Instead of going to church to understand, go to be flabbergasted. We have to have flabbergasting services. There's a better word than that, but I don't know. I don't know what you'd call it. We have to have, anyway, we got to have service, we got to have meetings where it takes us weeks to figure out what God did. How did He do that? Where the mystical realm opens up. Men and angels dance the dance of Mahanaim, which is the dance of two realms. God wants to feed you with mystery. Everybody say, inside of me is a golden jar full of wonder bread. The second is Aaron's rod. This was an almond rod, and an almond branch, very significant in the Hebraic mindset. Anyway, the 12 tribal heads each put a dead stick in the holy place as a test to see who God was anointing to be the priest, the priestly line. And whichever dead stick blossomed and budded and bore fruit in the holy place would qualify for priestly ministry. And it was Aaron's resurrection rod. And it's a picture of priests must pass from death to life. You must pass from one realm into another. And many priests are still operating in the death realm of the law that brings death. But we operate in spirit in a resurrection life. And personally, we must pass as priests, we must pass through death's gates. Our leprous king has to die. By the way, are you sitting down? Do you know that, you know what, do you know where John got the revelation? Where was he when the Apostle John got the book of Revelation? Patmos. Do you know what Patmos means? My killing. Go there and you'll see what he saw. That's where the revelation is found, only on Patmos. It's not a realm for the mind of man. It's the realm of spirit. It's the realm of life, resurrection, passing from death into a new realm. And if we keep reading the book of Revelation out of the death glasses, and judgment and doom and antichrist and everything horrible that's coming. No wonder we go and hide and hoard food and put seeds and start our gardens and get it weirded out. I'm old enough to know that the Pope wasn't antichrist, Gorbachev wasn't antichrist, Obama's not antichrist, and Justin Bieber's not antichrist. Quit saying that. Somebody told me that the other day. There's more. Listen, antichrist is a spirit that's already in the world. Been there 2,000 years. Actually, go back to about the sin of Adam and you'll find it. Antichrist anointing from the Christ emerging from you and I. Christ in heaven is not your hope of glory. Christ in you is the hope of glory. The third thing is the tablets of the law, broken by man's disobedience but fulfilled in Christ. And that tablet of the law, is it not written inside of us? Are the laws of God, the new covenant, is it not written now, not on tablets of stone, but on the fleshy portions of our spirit heart, where our heart and spirit join? I found the ark. And I found the temple. I found the bride. And you are lovely. So it speaks, as I conclude here, yeah, it's about 4:30. Let me wrap this up. Just a few more things about this love seat. It's the marriage carriage. I call it the mercy seat. It's the throne of grace. And the church is to be God's throne of grace on the earth. We are dispensers of mercy. Those sins you forgive will be forgiven. The mysterious verse there in John. We become God's throne of grace on the earth. We are to dispense mercy and grace to all. And it says that its interior was lovingly inlaid. It was upholstered with love, and it uses the word crimson, and of course that's sprinkling of blood. And if you'll read the translation I have there of Song of Songs, I footnote a lot of this and explain to you how this is clearly the mercy seat. It is absolutely the invitation to the bride to get into the mercy seat and go into the heavenly realm. The only legitimate access into heaven is by the mercy seat, blood-sprinkled pathway. And then it ends with the daughters of Jerusalem. Oh, I never explained what they are, who they are. The daughters of Jerusalem, they're also called the daughters of Zion later in the book, but the daughters of Jerusalem are the brides-to-be. They are those ladies-in-waiting. They are those who accompany the bride in her journey. They are not yet convinced, like perhaps a few of you here, not yet convinced, but they're following the bride. And the beautiful thing is at the end of the book, when they see how he treated her with nothing but love, nothing but tender affirmation, they are the ones that then say, "Let him kiss me." And the journey begins all over again. And Shulamites create Shulamites. When you enter into the bridal journey and you give your heart unreservedly, abandon, surrender to the flame, you become a magnet to the nations. You release and reveal something so powerful that in chapter 6, she's taken up into divine chariot of heaven. She goes up into the spirit realm in front of the daughters of Jerusalem, and they all freak out and they say, "Come back. Don't leave us, Shulamite. When you're near us, we feel his presence. There's something about you that looks like him. Come back. Come back, O Shulamite." And when you are full and saturated and soaked in the limitless love of God, people will taste and see. They'll eat of you. Because in chapter 5, he says to the priests at the gathering, he says, "Come and feast on her. When you taste of her, you taste of me. Drink your fill, O lovers. Come and drink from her well. Come and taste of her, because to feed upon her, you now feed upon me."
They've become so much united that her life is his and his life is hers. And to enter into this mystical union of oneness becomes, you become a feast for others. They will literally feast on your journey. They'll follow you and they'll curiously puzzle over you until they at last give up and say, let him kiss me. If you're going to treat me the way you treated her, come and do it to me. And the journey begins. In church history, there's always a Shulamite company. There's always a bridal company throughout the history of the church. And here in Australia, God has sent us here to tell you simply this. Go out and meet him. The bridegroom is in the land. Trim your lamps. Go out. Get outside the camp, the religious structures perhaps, and go out and meet him. The bridegroom is in the land. He's in Australia. And he's calling a bride. He's calling the Aussie bride. The Sheila, mate. He's calling the Aussie bride to arise. I can't think of anything that would heal the spirit of orphan over Australia and Tasmania like the revelation of the Song of Songs. I can't think of anything to heal the Aussie mate heart than the message of the Song of Songs. And the broken fatherlessness of the daughters and the men, perhaps, that could heal this nation and move us into the fullness where the bride gives birth to the virgin bride gives birth to the man-child company of Revelation 12. But that's another time. Jesus said, I have many things to say, but you're not ready. And I can just see myself saying, oh, but I am ready. Oh, tell me, Jesus. You got to tell me. I'm ready. Well, there's many things he has to say to us. Mysteries that transcend anything you've ever heard in Sunday school. Things that go way beyond what's on your podcast. Revelation secrets of the 12 gateways into eternity. The realm of heaven, the heavenly access, the 10 angelic rankings of angels around the throne and their purpose and their callings. There's so many encounters that are yet ahead of us. And as we get into the mercy seat, we go up to the high place. So the curtain falls, and the daughters of Jerusalem are all dancing around the mercy seat. They say, now we see how she's going to go. Come out, daughters of Jerusalem, and gaze upon your bridegroom. The day of his wedding has come. The day of his great gladness. He has a bride because she's ready now to go. And chapter 4 begins a brand new section. It's totally change. And he starts with her head, goes to her toes, from her nose to her toes, and tells her how beautiful this emerging bridal church of the last days is going to have the features that he speaks of and prophesies of in chapter 4. So come tonight, get a nice dinner, and we'll see you tonight. Oh, yeah, come on up, yes. Before we go, can we impose upon our precious friend, Carolyn, if you would come and put your shoes on.
Just while Carolyn's getting ready, is your daughter here who had that encounter last night looking the guys from Riot, is it right? Yeah, I was chatting to you before. Was it your... Is she here? This is an encounter conference, and I just was so touched when she was telling me what she could see last night in the worship. I thought it'll bless you because it's such in the line of what is going on here. Not all of us are able to see what God's doing in the Spirit, but that's where we're going. And that it becomes very normative. And just come and tell us quickly what you saw in the worship. What's your name?
Alex.
Hi.
Come in the light. Wow, okay, on the spot. Okay, so we were worshiping, and at the top of those lights, there's like a veranda, and they were like four angels, but big angels in white, waiting, sitting at top. They were waiting while we were worshiping. And then as the song changed, there were cherubims going around and ministering to people. So I believe there were healings happening and bondages being broken off people. And towards the end, the last song, the face of Jesus came up really white and bright, and he filled this whole arch. So he's really hearing, you're really tapping into a different dimension of his presence, something some of us will never have never seen before. So thank you.
Yeah, I'm just going to sing the last section of this chapter 3. Who is this Holy One?
Who is this Holy One arising out from the wilderness in a pillar of glory cloud? And he is perfumed with myrrh and frankincense, ascending in victory. Protection. Rise up, Zion maiden.
Well, this is actually a barrel of wine. You see, the roof is actually the, if you look beyond the lights, it's the house of wine. So have a drink. You can linger if you need to. We will have to, at some stage, just clean the auditorium. But there's cafes in the area. We'll get back together at 7. And we're just halfway through, so tonight and all day tomorrow. There's more. God bless you guys. Thank you.